What's up, Toronto? How we doing? So, my name is Rudy Francisco. I'm gonna do some poems, right? Throughout these poems, if you hear something that you like, something that moves you, right? Like you could snap your fingers. Let's try it together. We can snap our fingers, right? That's a little old school, but if you want to do that, that's fine. If you want to respond vocally, you can say something like ooh. Let's try it together. Ooh. Ooh. You can say what?
What?
You can say let's go.
Let's go.
You can also throw in an amen, hallelujah, Jesus take the wheel, ooh, kill him, turn up. That's my best friend. That part. Any of those things are completely fine. Are we ready? I said, Toronto, are we ready? All right. So first poem, short poem. A few things I strongly believe. If you believe in these things, you can snap your fingers. If you don't believe in these things, you can not do anything. So here we go. A few things I strongly believe. I believe that sour apple flavored anything is delicious. I believe that orange juice tastes better with pulp. I believe that Cinnabon is made by angels. I like Arizona iced tea, but 24 ounces of anything for a dollar is probably poison. For real. I believe that music is easier to digest than medicine. I believe that a good song can turn any room into a church. I believe that Whitney Houston's voice is all the proof I need to know God exists. Thank you. That's the end. Short poem. You clap. All right, another short poem. It's super short. It's even shorter than that poem. But I'm going to do some longer poems afterwards. All right, here we go. You ready? It's real short. All right. Racism is the drunk guy at the party who tries to fight everyone. No one wants to claim him. America says nothing and pretends they didn't ride in the same car. That's the end. All right, this next poem, I call it my honest poem. Not that my other poems aren't honest, right? I got a friend, right? My friend, his name is Richard. Richard, he doesn't like poetry, but he supports me. Like, one day, he was like, yo, Rudy, I don't understand any of your poems. And I was like, you've been watching me for, like, 4 years. And he was like, yeah, you know, I just clap when it's over because... And I was like, so what would you suggest that I do? Right? And he said, why don't you just write something honest? And at the time, my initial reaction was to be offended, right? But I had to do some introspection, right? And I realized at that time I was writing for Slam, right? And I was writing to compete. And it got to the point to where I was doing a poem and I was like, I don't even know whose voice this is. So I had to like scrap all my old poems and start over with this poem right here. I was born on July 27th. That makes me a Leo. I don't know what that means. I'm 5'6" and a half. I weigh 175 pounds. I don't know how to swim and I'm a sucker for a girl with a nice smile and clean sneakers. I'm still learning how to whisper. I'm often loud in places where I should be quiet. I'm often quiet in places where I should be loud. I was born feet first, and I've been backwards ever since. I like ginger ale. A lot. I've been told that I give really bad hugs. People say that it feels like I'm trying to escape. Sometimes it's because I am. Secretly, I get really nervous every time someone gets close enough to hear me breathe. I have this odd fascination with things like sandcastles and ice sculptures. I assume it's because I usually find myself dedicating time to things that will only last a few moments. That's also why I tend to fall in love with women who will never love me back. I know it sounds crazy, but it's actually much easier than it seems. And to be honest, I think it's safer that way. See, relationships, they often remind me that I'm not afraid of heights or falling, but I'm scared of what's gonna happen the moment that my body hits the ground. I'm clumsy. Yesterday, I tripped over my self-esteem. I landed on my pride, and it shattered like an iPhone with a broken face. Now, I can't even tell who's trying to give me a compliment. I've never been in the military, but I have this purple heart. I got it from beating myself up over things I can't fix. I know this sounds weird, but sometimes I wonder what my bed sheets say about me when I'm not around. I wonder what the curtains would do if they found out about all the things I've done behind their backs. I've got a hamper that's overflowing with really, really loud mistakes and a graveyard in my closet. I'm afraid that if I let you see my skeletons, you'll grind my bones into powder and get high on my fault lines. My name is Rudy. I enjoy frozen yogurt, people watching, and laughing for absolutely no reason at all. But I don't allow myself to cry as often as I need to. I have solar power confidence. I have a battery-operated smile. My hobbies include editing my life story, hiding behind metaphors, and trying to convince my shadow that I'm someone worth following. I don't know much, but I do know this. I know that heaven is full of music. I know that God listens to my heartbeat on his iPod. It reminds him that we still got work to do. Thank you. All right, how y'all feel? Y'all good?
Yeah.
All right, next poem. So there's this thing. It's called volcano surfing. It's a sport in which an individual rides down an active volcano at speeds up to 50 miles per hour using nothing but this wooden board. When I first heard about the activity, I thought to myself, it must be nice to feel so safe you have to invent new ways to put yourself in danger. And when the body thinks it may be swallowing its last breath, the adrenal glands release hormones into the blood. The skin becomes a cocktail of sweat and fear. The heart gets claustrophobic. It pounds against the chest like it needs to see what's on the other side. The lungs become newlyweds holding hands in a crashing airplane. This is called an adrenaline rush. I was about 18 when I started driving. I was about 18 the first time I was pulled over. The officer spilled his lights all over my rearview mirror. He splashed out of his car with his hand already on his weapon. He looked at me the way a tsunami looks at a beach house, and I could tell that he's the kind of man who brings a gun to a food fight. He called me son, and I thought to myself, that's an interesting way of pronouncing boy. He asked for my license, registration, wants to know what I'm doing in this neighborhood, if the car is stolen, if I have any drugs, and most days, y'all, I know how to grab my voice by the handle. I know how to swing it like a hammer, but instead, I picked it up like a shard of glass, scared of what might happen if I didn't hold on to it carefully, because I know that this much melanin, that uniform is a plot line to a film that can easily end with a chalk outline baptism, me trying to make a body bag look stylish for the camera and becoming the newest coat in a closet full of RIP hashtags. Once a friend of a friend asked me why there weren't more black people in the X Games, and I said, you don't get it. Being black is one of the most extreme sports in America. See, We don't need to invent new ways of risking our lives because the old ones have been working for decades. Jim Crow may have left the nest, but our streets are still covered in its feathers. Being black in America is knowing there's a thin line between a traffic stop and the cemetery. It's the way my body tenses whenever I hear a police siren in a song. It's the quiver in my stomach whenever there's a cop car behind me. It's the sigh of relief when I turn right and he doesn't. Being black in America is knowing that you're not safe in a hoodie, a t-shirt, a tuxedo. Being black in America is knowing that you're not safe in a pool, in a church, in a classroom. Hell, I don't need to go volcano surfing. I have an adrenaline rush every time an officer drives past without pulling me over. And I realize I'm gonna make it home safe. Well, this time. Thank you. All right, so this poem is a newer poem. I'm still trying to like work out some stuff with it. So is it okay if I do it? Is that all right? All right, here we go. I read somewhere that the Mexican government confiscates approximately 30,000 illegal firearms per year. When the guns are taken, they get dismantled and the metal is used to make other types of weapons that will later be utilized by the military. In 2012, Pedro Reyes, an artist from Mexico City, convinced his government to donate the guns to him so he could turn them into musical instruments. So somewhere, right, like there's a tambourine, a drum set, a guitar, all made out of things that were used to take people's lives, but now they create a sound that puts life back into people's bodies, which is to say that a weapon will always be a weapon, but we choose how we fight the war. And from this, I learned that even the most destructive instruments can still create a melody worth dancing to, and sometimes don't we also call that a battle? I wonder how long it took to convince the first rifle that it can hold a note instead of a bullet, but still fire into a crowd and make everyone move. When I was six, I was taught how to throw a punch in the 80s. That was the anti-bullying movement. And the first time one of my classmates took a yo mama joke a little too far, I remembered my training. So I turned his nose into a fountain, my fist 5 pennies. I closed my eyes. I made a wish. I came home with bloody knuckles and it was the first piece of artwork we hung on the fridge. I remember staring at my hands the same way you stare at a midterm when all your answers are correct. I didn't know what class this was, but I did know I was passing. And isn't that what masculinity has become? A bunch of dudes afraid of their own feelings, terrified of any emotion other than anger, constantly yelling at the shadows on the wall, but still having to realize that we're the ones standing in front of the light. We learn how to dodge a jab. We learn how to step in before we swing. We learn the heart is the same size as the fist, but we keep forgetting they don't have the same functions. We keep telling each other to man the fuck up when we don't even know what the fuck that even means. We turn our boys into bayonets. We point them in the wrong direction, pull their triggers, but ignore the damage they're doing in the distance. The word repurpose means to take an object and give it amnesia. It means to make something forget what it's been trained to do so you can use it for a better reason. I am learning how to use this body for a better reason. I am learning that this body is not a shotgun. I am learning that this body is not a pistol. I am learning that a man is not defined by what he can destroy. I am learning that a person who only knows how to fight can only communicate in violence, and that shouldn't be anyone's first language. Once, I came across a picture of a strange-looking violin. The caption said that it was made out of a rifle. And I thought to myself, someday, that could be me. Thank you. I got time for one more? Where's David? All right. So this is my last one. I got two more? I can do two more? All right. All right, so I'm going to do complainers, and then I'll do the love poem. All right, so here we go. Y'all make me feel like a rock star. This is awesome. All right, so here we go. Complainers. The following are all true stories. May 26, 2003, Aaron Ralston was hiking. A boulder fell on his right hand. He waited 4 days, then he amputated his own arm with a pocket knife. On New Year's Eve, a woman was bungee jumping in Zimbabwe. The cord broke. She then fell into a river and had to swim back to land in crocodile-infested waters with a broken collarbone. Claire Champlin was smashed in the face by a 5-pound watermelon being propelled by a slingshot. Matthew Brobus was hit by a javelin. David Striegel was actually punched in the mouth by a kangaroo. The most amazing part of these stories is when asked about the experience, they all smiled, shrugged, and said, "I guess things could have been worse." So go ahead. Tell me that you're having a bad day. Tell me about the traffic. Tell me about your boss. Tell me about the job you've been trying to quit for the past 4 years. Tell me the morning is a townhouse burning to the ground. Tell me the snooze button is a fire extinguisher. Tell me the alarm clock stole the keys to your smile, drove it into 7 a.m. in the crash, totaled your happiness. Tell me how blessed are we to have tragedy so small it can fit on the tips of our tongues. See, when Evan lost his legs, he was speechless. When my cousin was assaulted, she didn't speak for 48 hours. When my uncle was murdered, we had to send out a search party to find my father's voice. Most people have no idea that tragedy and silence often have the exact same address. So when your day is a museum of disappointments hanging from events that were outside of your control, when you find yourself flailing in an ocean of why is this happening to me, when it feels like your guardian angel put in his 2-week notice 2 months ago and just decided not to tell you, when it feels like God is a babysitter that's always on the phone, when you get punched in the esophagus by a fistful of life, remember that every year 2 million people die of dehydration. So it doesn't matter if the glass is half full or half empty. There's water in the cup. Drink that shit and stop complaining. You see, muscle. The muscle. Muscle is created by repeatedly lifting things that have been designed to weigh us down. So when your shoulders feel heavy, you gotta stand up straight. You gotta lift your chin. You gotta call it exercise. Remember that life is a gym membership with a really complicated cancellation policy. Remember that you will survive. Remember, things could be worse. Remember, we are never, ever, ever given anything that we can't handle. When the world crumbles around you, sometimes you gotta look at the wreckage and then build a new one out of all the pieces that are still here. Remember that you are still here. The human heart beats approximately 4,000 times per hour, and each pulse and each throb and each palpitation is a trophy engraved with the words, "You are still alive. You are still alive. So act like it." Thank you. All right, so this is my last poem. Are you ready? I'm sorry. I only got 20 minutes, you know? I have like 10 chat books with me, which I know is not a lot. I'm sorry, I was completely unprepared. I grabbed the wrong bag and I was like, oh, it's not the right one. So I only have 10 of them with me. I'm sorry, and they're $10. Exactly, like it surprises me too sometimes. I'll take 10 Canadian, I don't want to be complicated. You know. All right, so last one, y'all ready? All right, here we go. The first part of this poem is called "To the Girl Who Works at Starbucks Down the Street from My House on Delmar Heights Road, Swear to God, I'm Not a Stalker." That's the title. When I asked you for a chai latte, what I meant to say was, I was walking past, I saw you in the window, I came in here because I just had to know what your voice sounded like. Instead of saying that, I got really nervous and I just ordered the first thing on the menu. Honestly, I don't even know what chai is. Or a latte, for that matter. I imagine that when God made you, I bet he cussed for the first time. I bet he turned to an angel, gave him a high five, and said, "God damn, I'm good." Or me damn, I'm good, because he's God, you know what I mean? I spent the last 5 days trying to figure out how I'm gonna introduce myself to you properly. Finally figured it out. It's gonna be something like, "Hi." That's all I got so far. But I think it's a good start. I'm gonna be honest, it's not often that I find myself eager to write about love. In fact, every time I try to write about love, my hands cramp, just to show me how painful love can be. Sometimes my pencils break just to prove to me that every now and then love takes a little more work than you planned. I heard that love is blind, so I write all my poems in Braille. And my poems are never actually finished because true love is endless. I've always believed that real love is kind of like a supermodel before she's airbrushed. It's pure and imperfect, just the way that God intended. I'm gonna be honest, I'm not much of a love poet. But if I was to wake up tomorrow morning and decide that I was gonna write about love, my first poem it would be about you. About how I love you the same way I learned how to ride a bike. Scared, but reckless, with no training wheels or elbow pads so my scars can tell the story of how I fell for you. I'm gonna be honest, I'm not much of a love poet. But if I was, I'd write about how I see your face in every cloud and your reflection in every window. You see, I've written a million poems, hoping that somehow, maybe some way you'll jump out of the page and be closer to me. You see, I'm not a love poet, but if I was, I'd write about how you have the audacity to be beautiful, even on days when everything around you is ugly. I'd write about your eyelashes and how they are like violin strings that play symphonies every time you blink. If I was a love poet, I'd write about how I melt in front of you like an ice sculpture every time I hear the vibration in your voice. I know it's gonna sound strange, but every now and then I pray that God turns you back into one of my ribs just so I'll never have to spend an entire day without you. And I swear, I'm usually not a love poet, but if I was to wake up tomorrow morning and decide that I was gonna write about love, my first poem, it would be about you. After all of that, she was like, "So how do you feel about me?" I said, "Let's put it like this. I want to be your ex-boyfriend stuntman. I want to do everything he never had the courage to do. Like, trust you. I swear, and when our lips touch, I can taste the next 60 years of my life. See, last night I had a dream, right? In this particular dream, I died in my dreams, awoke not knowing I was still asleep and decided to walk. You see, that night, I walked in my sleep. I slept in my walk. I walked backwards until I saw you for the first time and I could barely muster the courage to introduce myself all over again. You see, I've been trying to find the right words. I've been trying to take the right steps for what seems to me like thousands of years, but something always seems to go wrong between us. We lived in Egypt. I was the Pharaoh's slave. You were his daughter. Loving you led to my death. They claimed I seduced you, and after they stole my life, I was resurrected as a mason. I made the foundation for your house. We met eyes for 2 seconds. You left, and I didn't see you again until I died. I came back as a caterpillar. I turned into a butterfly. I landed in the palm of your hands. You brushed me away, and the rejection killed me. When I woke, I was a kick drum. You were a snare. We were both owned by this drummer named Cozy Cole, and when he died, so did we, but I came back just to look for you. I left notes in random places, hoping that you would stumble across them. I carved our names in trees, and then prayed that it would jog your memory. I whispered your name in the wind, hoping somehow, maybe some way, my voice would reach you, but it didn't, and I died. I died early. I died young with breadcrumbs in my hand, just hoping that you would find me, but you never did, so they buried me. When they buried me, they put these coins over my eyes, and I used them as bus fare to get back to Earth just so I could look for you. That's why sometimes when we hold hands, every so often, I tend to hold on a little too tight, and I'm sorry. I just don't want to lose you again. My mother, she told me that when you find the perfect woman, you got to do whatever it takes to make sure she stays next to you. Thank you, Toronto Slam. It's my time.